Carlos Aguilar, film critic, my very special guest tonight. Thank you very much for making the time for me.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, we met over about just a week ago. I want to mention two things. We met through Laura Astorga.
Laura, that's right. Laura is a film director from Costa Rica.
That's
she
right.
made a film called Red Princesses, Princesas Rojas, and it's the official submission for the Oscars for representing Costa Rica. So she's a dear friend, and that's how we met.
Yeah. It was beautiful. Laura, you know, she sent me a message on Facebook. I don't know. People love it. People hate it. I love Facebook. I don't call me shallow, sue me, arrest me, call me superficial. It doesn't matter. I mean, I think it's so wonderful to be on Facebook, check your friends, see what they're doing. You know, it's just great. And she sent me this message. This is a great guy. Carlos Aguilar, we have film critic. We have still his name right at the bottom. Gloria, maybe we can put him on the shot or get his name out of the shot. Because there you go. Now I'm directing my show again. And now I feel like John Rivers. This is not good. Okay, anyway, let's go back to the chase. She sent me a message. I said, you got to meet this wonderful kid. He's a young guy. He's in his 20s. But he's such a smart, bright film critic. And I said, okay, we're going to get to know him. And you know what? If he's in New York, yeah, I want to bring him on the show. So let's do that. So thank you for making the time. Before we get into our conversation, I just want to send my regards to Jen Danby, Lisa Raymond, my dear friends there in L.A. Jen, she's doing Sharon Tate in Heaven. She's in the Lee Strasberg Institute. And she sent me the pictures on Facebook with Sharon Tate's sister, Deborah. Lovely pictures. I love the fact that they love your work, Jen. I think is well deserved. You put a lot of love into this work, and I went to see it quite a few times, and we want to make a movie out of this. So I'm really excited for you, baby girl. I'm sending my love to you and Lisa and everybody in LA.
That's right. We are
streaming live, Carlos.
Yeah, that's right.
Oh, yeah, this is no joke. We're going live.
The real deal.
I want to consider that. Yeah, we say it's a real deal. We're going live right in the city, Channel 56, 7:30 p.m. every Friday night. And we're streaming live. Worldwide, so it's pretty exciting. I don't want to make
you pressure.
I'm not putting pressure on you, Carlo, but what the hell? We gotta do what we gotta do.
That's right.
So let's talk about you, LA, becoming a film critic. You're very young. You're already what,
25.
You're not even 27. I thought you were 27.
It's birth.
I know. It's the look, the hat. You look like a film critic. How did you decide to become a film critic? Going back in time, because you're from Mexico, right?
That's right, yep.
And then you develop all this love for film. So let's talk about that.
I actually didn't set out to be a film critic. I just don't really think most people that do film criticism, you know, decide, you know, one day wake up and like, I'm going to be a film critic. It happened that I've always loved films. I was a kid. My mom used to take me to the movies every week. Like, we'll go, you know, once a week, we'll go to the movies, like, religiously. That's the one treat I got every week. And, you know, for birthdays, I wanted to go to the movies. So I started developing this kind of, this love for film that when I grew older, like 12, 13, I started, you know, exploring films from other countries, from France, from Spain. And I still want to be a film director.
Right. But, you still do?
I still do, yeah.
Okay.
But, film criticism or film journalism in general just came about in a rather organic way. After high school, I was set out to go to school to film production.
Right.
But as we know, it's very expensive. So
right.
I had to make a choice, you know, how could I still get it, be involved in film while not having, you know, to spend that much money? Because, of course, if I, you know, I wanted to continue a career in film, but we know that it's very... It's not something that happens really easy. It's not like there's not a clear path. It's not like, you know,
right.
You become an engineer, you look for a job, you know.
Yeah, and you're all set. People, they don't seem to understand, and I want to bring that up. And I know this just sounds kind of basic. Oh, wait a second with the sound. I'm wearing all my jewels and all my things, my gold, my silver, and I'm making all these crazy sounds. Kelly Camacho is my dear friend and hostess. Her mother, she does all these beautiful things. So I want to wear each one of them on the show. That any profession related to acting, filmmaking, stage, right? Painting. I mean, every single artist in this world, you can go to school, you can study, you can have all the talent and all the skills, but not necessarily. That doesn't mean that you're going to make a living.
Nope, it doesn't.
And people, they don't seem to, some people, they don't seem to really understand what we do.
It takes a
lot. It's a tough choice. It's a labor of love.
It's passion. Yeah.
And passion.
That's what it is. You want it more than all the things that tell you that you're not going to make it, you know?
Right.
It has to be, you have to have that passion, that dream or that goal, regardless of what's around you. Because if you start letting, you know, people trying to, you know, tell you like that's not going to happen, it's not realistic.
Yes.
It could throw you back or throw you out of your zone if you're trying to achieve something. So I started writing my own blog first. So I started writing film reviews that I would go to the movies, I'll pay my own ticket and watch it.
Right.
And I'll start writing. From there, I look for small outlets, you know, online. These days, online is, you know, the easiest way to, like, become a critic or write about film in general.
Right.
So I started writing for a small outlet. Then from there, things didn't really work out. So I looked for another outlet, which, you know, I started developing contacts, and, you know, you start getting into the groove of how the industry works, the screenings and the festivals and all this.
Right.
And things develop organically, as I said, that, you know, I wrote a piece that someone liked, that one of the blogs on IndieWire. IndieWire is one of the prominent sites.
Yes.
So I started writing for Sidney Levine, Sidney's Buzz on IndieWire.
IndieWire, what else?
Let's
mention it, because yeah, it's a lot of work. You're doing great work. IndieWire, right? What else?
Movie Maker Magazine.
Movie Maker Magazine, yes.
Creative Screenwriting.
Creative Screenwriting.
A couple other small ones, but those are like the ones that focus on, you know. And I also try to do a little bit of other things related to film, like I read screenplays, I do a little programming of festivals. I think that's one of the things that you need to mention, that when you want to do something in film, whether it's criticism or anything, you know, related to film, you can't just do one thing, you know. You have to, you know, look for other things. Like, if you want to be a critic, you might also want to, you know, work for a festival or, you know, start a volunteer and then become a programmer, you know, watch films for them, read screenplays.
Right.
Things that will get you the contacts, will get you, you know, entrance to the things that you want to do and the people that you have to meet, because otherwise it's very difficult if you try to focus on only one thing and you're,
right,
you know, set on that. So.
And it seems like we're living in times that we have to be resourceful. We have to be like,
that's right,
you got to do this, you got to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Right, you have to be willing to learn as much as you can, because everything is done with a click. I don't care, your phone, you can film a movie on your phone.
That's right. So imagine if everyone is able to write criticism, you know, you have to have something special, not special, but different, or, you know, your own voice to make your way in the industry. Because
right
now everyone could be a critic. Now everyone could have a blog, you know, right? Everyone has an opinion, and everyone
right
puts their opinion online. So
right,
you
and
have
with
to
Facebook and with Twitter,
well,
and
right,
with all these outlets, you can just, anybody can just be anything.
So how
much
do you get yourself, you know, have a place or have a specific voice within the industry? So I think that's the challenge nowadays. It's not really so much how do you get it out there, because there's many outlets. It's how do you, know, get credibility, or, you know, make a name for yourself with,
right,
in all these big.
Yeah, because it's not a lot of competition, but you're right, everybody has access to,
that's right,
different ways of expression, right? And it's kind of like, you know, the competition could be a little bit overwhelming, but as long as you know what you're doing, you have a passion for film.
That's right.
Correct? I mean, and I can see in your writing, you love detail. You pay attention,
yeah,
to detail, correct?
Yeah, that's right. You have to. I mean, film is, there's so many intricate things that happen when you make a film. Someone makes a film, you know, you have the customs, the editing, the music, the acting. It's all one big collective project. So when you're analyzing a film, or when you're trying to decipher what it is about, what the film, you know, is trying to tell you, because, you know, it's a very personal opinion, what a film means to me, something, it might mean something to me that doesn't mean to another person, you know. Someone could interpret that film in a different way.
Right.
But when I watch a film, I want to focus on the small details, you know, what makes that story different from the rest of the films? What makes this particular director, his style, what do I like about him that other directors don't know how to do? So
right, right, and the context is so important.
Correct.
Right?
Especially, I write a lot about foreign films.
Right.
So when you're writing about a film from, I don't know, Eastern Europe, Southeast Asia, South America, you have to take into account the fact that these filmmakers are working in different conditions than the American market. So
right,
it's not the same thing to make a film in California, New York, than make it in Iran or, you know, North Africa. So the challenges that those directors or filmmakers, actors or artists, you know, face in those countries, they're not necessarily playing to how I feel about the film, but the context of the story, you know, what is, how does this person perceive poverty in his part of the world? How does this person perceive religion? And, you know,
right,
I can pretend, or I can try to understand their point of view without taking into account where they're coming from, you know. So
right,
that's very important.
But you, the sense of awareness that you have,
correct,
the sense of awareness, you're deep. You get into the story, but you obviously you're critical, using the same word. You're much into detail, but I noticed that, yeah, you have to know the context. You have to understand where these filmmakers are coming from. in terms of the writing, in terms of the story,
yeah.
right? And what I like about foreign films, I mean, there's so much great talent everywhere when you really think about it. Sometimes I think we concentrate energy too much in what's going on here. This is a big country, it's a powerful country, and God bless America,
mm-hmm.
right?
Correct.
There's a lot of wonderful things taking place in other
Yeah, I mean, film is an
places.
Industry. It is an industry here.
Right.
In other places, I think it's still, it could be an industry, but other countries, they still see it more as an art form without this commercial kind of, you know,
right.
Context written in it. In the U.S., you know, I mean, all filmmakers want to make
Sell
a living.
It.
Yeah, they want to make a living out of it, you know, but it's not the same when you're trying to market a film that has, like, big name actors, it's a blockbuster, and you want to put it in like 2,000 screens, then when you have a small film from France and you want to put it in a couple dozen screens in the US, you know, so
right.
the strategy is different, the profit is different, and the way these filmmakers get access to make another film, that's another challenge, you know, so every
right.
time they make a film, it's a challenge. There's not a machine like in the studios, you know?
Yes.
That the studio has the resources and the filmmaker that's, you know, part of the studio could, you know, make a film. And I mean,
right.
they still have faced challenges, of course. It's not easy to make a film in any context, but I feel like foreign films, each country represents a different
reality.
Landscape. Yeah, a different reality. So when you try to make a film in one of some of those countries, you might have more access to government help that we don't have in the U.S. Like,
right.
there's a lot of funds in Europe, funds in other countries that, you know, the government tries to subsidize film or, like, you know, help the filmmakers, but still it's harder to get those films seen if you don't have Brad Pitt, you know.
Right. I mean, because what do you do? It's like we talk about making films, and the cleaning guy is doing a hell of a job. I can hear you from here, but that's besides the point, man. I'm like hoping, keeping my fingers crossed. Oh my God, can we have quiet on the set? But hey,
it's life.
It's life, and you gotta do what you gotta do. Films are hard to make. It takes, obviously, passion. You have to write your story, get your guts, get your heart, get your cast, right?
Mm-hmm.
Develop your own idea.
And get the money.
And get the money.
You gotta get the
get
money.
Get the money. So what do you think? I mean, what's the biggest challenge for new filmmakers? Because there's a lot of buzz about the fact that everybody has, like with a small camera, with a digital camera, you can shoot a film.
Yeah.
You can even, I've seen auditions because I'm an actor and I audition too, and I get out there, and sometimes when you go out there and people are filming the audition with a cell phone.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you think? I mean, what's the idea for new filmmakers, for newcomers? Is it easier, is it more difficult really?
I think it has to do with the thing. So one, of course, nowadays there's more access to equipment, to cheaper ways to make a film. Most films are not shot in film, 35 millimeter
right,
anymore.
Right, it's so expensive.
Expensive, so they're done in digital,
right.
which of course is cheaper. So there's more access, of course, which obviously doesn't mean that the stories will get better just because they're access. So the story still has to be, you know, the center of the film.
Yes,
it has to be the center of the film. But the fact that there's so many films out there, the market could sometimes feel crowded, you know?
Right.
There's so many films, there's only a certain amount of screens, there's only so many films that a person could watch a year. So how do you target that market that's specific to your film, you know? Like if you're making a film about, you know, LGBT content, or you're making a film about, you know, I don't know, war films, or about art, or, you know, a documentary.